Thank you for bringing the church. Let's stand together and get our worship started this morning with Our God. Stand with me, please.
Church. It's wonderful to see you here this morning. Thank you for braving the ice and coming out to be with us here this morning. As always, we have the connection cards in the chair in front of you, and if you're a visitor here this morning, we'd appreciate it if you'd fill out the connection card so that we could have a record of your visit here. It's also used for prayers that you'd like for the prayer team to have and to intercede on your behalf. The story groups continuing to meet this coming week. There's an insert in the bulletin for the different groups and where they meet. There's a note here. Some groups have moved as the leaders have gone down south, so there are some changes there. Tyler, you take that number three there?
Yes. The annual meeting will be held this Monday, February 11th at 7 p.m. Mark that in your calendars. Make sure to be here. We have some votes going on. And in your bulletins, there is a constitution insert. This is a change to Article 23 Prayer Committee. Please read it and come ready to vote on this during the annual meeting.
And there's an announcement here about the Alpha Group at Riverside Albert on January 27th, that's today. And supper at 5:30 and a video and conversation to follow. Tyler has an announcement about CR.
So our CR group has started full-time, open to the public. Anyone is welcome at 7 p.m. every Sunday night in the entryway, right in front of the front doors on that little kiosk on the side. There's some bulletins there. If you know of anyone who might benefit from CR, if you yourself, go ahead and pick one up and take a look at it, and we hope to see some people out there Sunday nights. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Tyler. And it's greeting time now, so if you would all take a moment to greet one another, and thank you.
Continue our morning. Let's find our seats once again. You have that in your ears? Alright, so this next song might be a new song to some people here in this church. For you that don't know me, my name is Daryl Miller. I've been doing worship for a while in the church that I come from, and this is my home now, and there's going to be a few new songs that come with me. This song, I think this is perfect timing where we have people coming back from Guatemala. The chorus, glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. God, fill this place, bless this church, bless the people in it. We just thank you for the lives you've given us, even though sometimes it's difficult. We just thank you for the praises, we just thank you for everything that you do for us. That's good. In your precious name, I pray, amen.
Sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. So skill to understand what God has will, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. In my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior, that He would leave His place on high and come a sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. This living, dying, let me bring My strength, my soul is from this praying, that he who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior, that he would leave his place on high and come a sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, it's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God, is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome all the people that are watching online this morning. You know, people watch this service online every week all over the country and even all around the world. Especially we like to welcome the people in the Tide this morning, Alma, as they worship and tune in on our message each Sunday and our music. We just thank you for them and an opportunity to serve them in that way. I'd like to ask the ushers to come forward at this time as we receive the Lord's tithes and our offerings. In Corinthians chapter 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 and 7, it says, "The one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully." And then in verse 7, "Each one of you must give as you've made up your mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." Let's pray together. Oh Lord, we are the receivers. Receivers of love, receivers of grace, receivers of Jesus. We are the givers, following God's call, following Jesus, following our hearts. Lord, we give these offerings for the work of your kingdom with humble thanks for the mercies received from you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
The Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We are gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God sings, our God. In your name. Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We are gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to call on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of the offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. Mourning turns into songs of
beautiful reminder, our God saves. Sometimes we forget how powerful our God is, the Almighty One. And I'm so thankful for the songs that we sang this morning to remind us of the amazing grace and the amazing love and the amazing power of our God. Can I have all the kids come on up? And I'm going to pray with you before we go out. Come on up. Come on up. Come and sit or stand. And we're all going to pray together this morning. It's so good to be back and see all your beautiful faces. Come on up. You're a little bit tired? Me too, kiddo. You do? Okay, well, we're going to ask for strength this morning then. From our... Okay. The power of prayer, there is power in prayer. And so we are going to pray to the one who has all the power, the Almighty One, El Shaddai. Okay? Dear God, I thank you so much for you and for your love, for your amazing love. God, I thank you for those who were on the Guatemala team that were able to experience the songs of praise from your people, from two different cultures, Lord. God, I thank you for that opportunity, and I am thankful for safety as we all were able to come to church this morning. God, I thank you for your little children all around the world that are singing your songs of praise this morning to a God who is almighty, to a God who saves. And Lord, sometimes you don't change our circumstances, but God, you give us a hope, a living hope, and we know that we love you and that you love us, God. I thank you for your everlasting love. Lord, I thank you for children, and God, I thank you for the joy, and I thank you for renewed joy. In your precious name, Jesus, we pray to you. And Lord, we pray in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Lord, in your name. Amen. All right, off we go.
Let's come before the Lord in prayer. Our gracious and heavenly Father, we come to you today in the name of Jesus. We're so thankful for this privilege of meeting together as your people to worship and honor you. We're encouraged and strengthened as we sing and pray together, as we hear the message from your word. We're challenged in our walk with you. We need to hear from you today. We need to be drawn closer to you. We are needy people, and we earnestly seek your will and your way. We want to live lives of holiness and purity. That's why we're here today. We need you, O God, and we must feel your presence near us, not only in church on Sunday, but out there in our everyday lives, because we are the church every day. We're still the church in our homes, and when we're doing our business, in the classroom, in the factory. We want to portray the Spirit of Christ every day, Meeting together here every week gives help to make it through the days ahead. Now, Lord, as you look down inside of each of us, we know that you can see all the things that are there that no one else can see. And as we reach out to you, we know that you are already reaching out to us. We pray for forgiveness for those who have failed you. We pray for encouragement and uplift for those who are discouraged. We pray for comfort for those who are sorrowing and sad. We pray for physical healing and restoration of those with sickness and problems. Lord, we're all different, but we all need the assurance of your loving presence. Thank you that you're always there, and we can depend on you. We pray for the communities where we live and work. Help us to be the influence for holiness and right that will make a difference. We pray, too, for our local leaders that they will make right decisions that will direct us in the right path. We pray for our pastor, Jeff, today, as he brings your word each week to us. May we continue to sense your anointing upon him. We pray for Jillian, Megan, Katrina, our deacons, our treasurer, and all who give leadership in our congregation. May we all give them our prayers and our encouragement. We give you thanks, O God, for hearing us. When our hearts are bursting with joy or excitement, when our lives are pain-free and things are going as planned, when we encounter new opportunities or successes, you hear our thanksgiving. Even with the psalmist, we affirm that there are simply not enough words in the world to adequately describe the nature and magnitude of your grace towards us. Lord, we also recognize not only that you hear us in times of prosperity, but in times of lack, in times of pain. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that when our hearts are heavy and burdened and hurting or discouraged, you can hear every word of desperation. And you can personally identify with every tear. There are times when you lift us out of difficult circumstances, but our greatest need is not better circumstances, but a hope and a joy that cannot be contained by circumstances in the first place. As we move forward into a new year as a church, we ask for the Holy Spirit to give us spiritual alertness. In a world that's controlled by earthly human success, give us hearts that value faithfulness. Teach us how to listen and recognize your voice in our lives. Burden our hearts as we proclaim the good news of Jesus. Show us thoughtful, engaging, and effective ministry strategies. And remind us that no area of service or ministry is unimportant. From caring for babies to encouraging our elderly, everything matters. We want our lives and ministry to be a reflection of and a response to the life of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Father God, keep our eyes focused on Jesus. Help us to see the needs around us and meet those needs in Christ with our resources. Make us a church that desires to love in both word and deed. We ask this so that the name of Jesus would be made much of in our village, in our county, and wherever we go. And it's in his name that we pray, and also pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when they asked him how they should pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Have you ever noticed how many warning signs and warning labels there are these days? I remember when they first started putting warnings on cigarette packages. And that was a long time ago now. But there's warnings on a lot of things. We see them on food products and personal hygiene items. We hear them on advertisements for prescription drugs. They warn us about everything that could happen to us if we take those drugs, even it might be death. But they're good for us, they say. They're everywhere. In my opinion, they go a bit overboard. This week, I found out that I'm not the only one who feels that way. There's an anti-lawsuit organization in Michigan that keeps track of warning labels that they deem to be unnecessary to show the negative impact of these warnings can have on business. This watchdog group has even compiled a list of what they think are the silliest. And here are a few examples. They found an ad for a tractor that came with this: caution, avoid death. You may have heard the next one. They found a stroller with a warning label on it that said, warning, remove infant before folding stroller for storage. I guess some people need to be warned about that. They found a Batman costume that said, warning, cape does not enable user to fly. That one is really silly because everyone knows Batman can't fly, only Superman can fly. One more, and this is my favorite. They found a sign on electric fence that said this: touching wires causes instant death, $200 fine. I can see that you agree that these warning signs are too funny to take seriously, but there are some warnings we should heed. There are some times when we need to be warned. I noticed driving home through the storm down 114, there were signs on the road that said, water ahead, caution, water ahead. Well, I paid attention because I didn't know how deep the water was, whether I was going to slide off the road. They're good warning signs that tell us what's coming. We need to listen up to those kinds of warnings and avoid devastating consequences. I bring this up because in our study of the story, this past week, we looked at a special group of people, special messengers that God gave the job of warning his people. The task was to warn them if they didn't change their behavior, destruction was coming. Tim, if you put up that verse in Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 15, the warnings, first God's first warning to people. No, there we go. The Lord, the God of their fathers, sent persistently to them by his messengers, because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place. God was warning them about their plight. Understand, God sent these messengers, also known as prophets, before the Israelites fell off the edge, so to speak, before tragedy struck, before there was devastation, before sin took root, so as to warn his people in time for them to make some changes. The nation of Israel had split into two nations, Israel in the north and Judah in the south. And the years that followed that split were a chapter in God's history of God's chosen people when things went from bad to worse. These were years of spiritual decline and unprecedented immorality, 208 years to be exact. To give you an idea how bad the decline was, according to the biblical record of these 208 years, the combined kingdom had 38 different kings in those 208 years. And only five were good. The rest were evil. And they led the Hebrews to do evil things. But Israel, God's chosen nation, the people through whom God would reveal himself to the rest of the world as part of his plan to create a perfect community. In just 208 years, they had 33 rulers that God's book judges as being evil. This is because these kings allowed and encouraged abominable practices to go on, making this a very sad time. Indeed, in this part of God's story, over and over we read about God using tragic words like these to describe evil words. They followed the ways of Jeroboam and caused my people to sin. They were following their king, caused them to sin. The main sin of these rulers, the root of all the decadence, was idolatry. And you should remember that started with the two Boehm brothers, as I call them, Jeroboam and Rehoboam. King Jeroboam in the northern kingdom became afraid that his people would go south to worship in the temple. So he had two golden calves made and invented his own substitute religion that had been around for a number of years, the worship of the idol Baal. He told the people, so to speak, don't go south to worship in Jerusalem. Traffic is a mess. You can never find a parking place for your camel near the temple. Just stay here and worship these idols. King Rehoboam in the south led his people to worship false gods as well. And over the years, the idolatry in both kingdoms got worse and worse. It got so bad that, to be honest, if I were God, I would have quit and started all over again. Well, I would have hit the delete button, wipe out these rebellious people on the face of the earth and begin again. But you remember from the story of Noah that God did that once and promised never to do it again. And God never breaks his promises. But God loves his chosen people, even if they don't reciprocate. It's part of the upper story that's so difficult for us to comprehend. Why does he love us so much? If he said he learned to tolerate us, I could see that. But he loves us with an everlasting love. He loves us no matter what, even when we rebel. He wants nothing more than to call us back to him, so he can live within us. For 208 years, God patiently waited for his children to heed his call, to give up their idols and return to him. But he didn't wait passively. He sent his messengers or prophets to warn the people and to call them back to God's ways. They were the voice of God to his people. In fact, they always introduced these speeches and their warnings with these words, "Thus saith the Lord." Thus saith the Lord. These messengers or prophets came from all kinds of backgrounds. Some were noblemen in the courts of kings. Others were priests. Still others were farmers and herdsmen and plain humble working folk. But they all spoke the same basic language. Return to the Lord and his law. Beware of his judgment. And above all things, look for the glorious future day of the Messiah. You know, we could do well from that same warning today in our societies. Return to the Lord and his law. Beware of his judgment. And above all things, look for the glorious future day of the Messiah. In the northern kingdom alone, God raised up 9 prophets during this 208-year period to try and convince the people to turn from their sin. Perhaps the best-known prophet during this period was Elijah, a man who served God during the reign of a wicked northern kingdom ruler named Ahab and his infamous wife, Queen Jezebel. Be sure you understand, this queen was not like a Jezebel. We use that term today sometimes. Oh, she's just like a Jezebel. This was the original Jezebel. She led her husband to promote the worship of false gods named Baal and Asherah. She was in full support of this practice. And Ahab, her husband, supported her in this. She had several prophets of God executed. God sent Elijah to confront this evil duo and to call Israel back to worshiping the one true God. By the way, Elijah's name actually reflected his assignment. The second part of his name, Jah, is from Yahweh. And the first part, Eli, comes from Elohim. So his name means the Lord is God. The Lord is God. And Elijah's job was to remind Israel that the Lord, not Baal, that the Lord is God. As the punishment for the idolatry of Ahab and Jezebel, and to get the people's attention, Elijah prophesied that there would be no more rain until he, Elijah, said so. And indeed, no rain fell for 3.5 years. caused a terrible famine during that time in Israel, and it shows that God takes idolatry seriously. Another indication of this was the fact that God put more than 1,000 verses in our Bible that speak against this sin of adultery. Plus, the first two commandments of the Ten Commandments deal with adultery. And it's one of the only four commandments that has a death penalty attached to it. God takes idolatry seriously indeed. So why is this so? Why idolatry is such a big deal? Well, remember what we've seen so far in our study. The story is all about the glory of God. And idolatry tries to steal God's glory. Plus, God loves us so he's zealous for a relationship with you and with me, an exclusive one with each of us. Idolatry is still around in our day and age. It's more subtle. We don't see any golden calves these days. But many people seek to push God off his throne and worship modern-day idols. This week I read of a tool that we can use to ferret out our own personal idols. And believe it or not, it was invented way back in the 17th century by a Puritan preacher named David Clarkson. Clarkson came up with several questions that can help people identify the idols in their hearts. These are idol diagnostic tools for us to use. And here they are. See if they bring an idol that you're worshiping, perhaps without even knowing it, into the light. These questions. Question one, what are you most disappointed with right now? Maybe it's your job. Maybe it's your financial status. Whatever, but this is a good question for us to consider. But the thing that we are most disappointed with points to something we can have put our hope in. We must remember that only God can give us true hope, a hope that is steadfast and sure. The second question that Dr. Clarkson said is, what do you sacrifice your time and your money for? Remember, the Bible says that where your treasure is where your heart is. Our checkbooks and our credit card bills can reveal the God within our hearts, the God we truly worship. Question three, what do you worry about? What scares you? That's a good question because the answer can show who or what we revere or fear the most. The psalmist said, the Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? Fearing anything but God is elevating it to an idol status. It also reduces God to a being who either does not care about our needs or is not able to meet them. Question four, where do you go when you get hurt or when life is hard? Where do you go to find comfort? If we go to anyone or anything other than God, there's a good chance that thing or person can become an idol for us. Perhaps for you and me, it's turning to God for direction as a last resort. First, we try to solve things ourselves rather than going to God first. A man I used to work for as president of Crandall University, I was teaching there at the time, and he had a little sign on his desk, and he sat behind the desk, and you sat in a chair in front of the desk facing him, and he had a little sign. It drove me crazy because I'd go in to talk to him about a problem I was having with some of the students, and the sign said, did you pray about it? I hated that sign because it made me feel so guilty because I hadn't prayed about it. I just was trying to solve it myself. The fifth question is, whose applause do you long for? Who do you want most to please in life? If the answer is not God, you could have a problem. Whatever these questions lead you to discover, don't be surprised if there's a drought in your life that matches up with the thing that's become equal to God in your heart. God's not going to bless his primary competition. If your career has reached idol status, it becomes more important than God. Don't be surprised by that pink slip. Oh, we're downsizing. We're going to have to let you go. Or we're restructuring. We're going to have to let you go. If finances are number one, if your security is linked to the size of your bank account or your RRSP, don't be surprised if your balances sink and shrink. God won't bless his competition, because he wants us to realize who he really is and he is the one true God. The opposite is also true. When we put God first, when we put him in the right place, we shouldn't be surprised if he showers us with blessings. I've seen this. People who put God first in their careers, people who work with integrity as unto the Lord, and are often elevated to jobs of high status, just as Joseph was in the Bible. And the people who honor God with their finances, people who tithe and are good stewards of their money, people can trust that God can trust with material blessings, tend to have an abundance of them. Other than the treasurer of the church, we don't like it much when the preacher talks about money. You may be getting squirmy right now that I talked about it. Remind me of the preacher in the southern United States. He loved to preach, and the people in the congregation were very responsive. He said, the church has got to pray. And the people hollered, amen, brother, let her pray. He says, the church has got to serve. Amen, brother, let her serve. The church has got to tithe. Silence. One guy pokes the other. He says, now he's gone from preaching to meddling. Let's get back to this part. We look at this verse in 1 Kings 17, verse 1. Now Elijah the Tishbite, the Tishbe in Gilead, said to Ahab, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom before whom I stand, there shall be neither dew nor rain these years except by my word. This is when he prophesied this. For 3.5 years, they had this drought. And then later in 1 Kings, beginning at verse 1 Kings 18, verse 17. And when Ahab saw Elijah, he said to him, oh, it's you, troubler of Israel. And he answered, I have not troubled Israel, but you have, and your father's house, because you've abandoned the commandments of the Lord and followed the Baals. Now, therefore, send all Israel to me at Mount Carmel, and the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table. So Ahab sent all the people of Israel and gathered the prophets together at Mount Carmel. And Elijah came near to all the people and said, how long will you go limping between two different opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal, then follow him. And the people didn't answer him a word. Then Elijah said to the people, I, even I only, am left the prophet of the Lord. But Baal's prophets are 450 men. Let two bulls be given to us. And let us then choose one bull for ourselves, each of us, and cut it into pieces and lay it on the altar on the wood, but put no fire to it. And I will prepare the other bull, lay it on the wood and put no fire to it. And you call upon the name of your God, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God. The people answered, that's well spoken. I'm sure the prophets of Baal were happy with this challenge because Baal was predominantly thought of as a god of the weather, lightning and rain. And it hadn't rained for 3.5 years. So the challenge was accepted. Everybody gathered at Mount Carmel near the modern-day Haifa. Two bulls were chosen, one for each altar. The 850 false prophets went first. They tried from early morning till late in the afternoon in vain to get their God to respond. They ranted and raved, and they cut themselves to get his attention. They danced around the altar and begged Baal to show up, but to no avail. At this point, Elijah gives us what may the first historical idea of trash talk. 1 Kings 18, verse 27. At noon, Elijah mocked them. He said, crying aloud, for he is either good, either he's musing, or he's gone to the bathroom, maybe. He's relieving himself. He's on a journey. Perhaps he's asleep, must be awakened. And they cried even louder and cut themselves with their swords and lances, till the blood gushed out upon them. And as midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of oblation. But there was no voice. No one answered for Baal. No one paid attention. Sunday school teacher was carefully explaining the story of Elijah the prophet and the false prophets of Baal. She explained how Elijah had built an altar and he put wood on it and he cut the steer that they had selected into pieces and laid it on the altar. And then Elijah commanded the people of God to fill 4 barrels of water and pour it on the altar. He had them do this 3 times, I think. "Now," said the teacher, "can anyone in the class tell me why the Lord would have Elijah pour water over the bull that was on the altar?" The little girl in the back raised her hand. She says, with great enthusiasm, "Oh, I know, to make the gravy." Elijah, in 1 Kings 18, verses 36 to 27, says this, "O God, O Lord God of Abraham," when it was his turn to pray, he said, "O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are the God in Israel, that I am your servant, and I've done these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, the Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again." Then the fire of the Lord fell from the sky and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, the soil, and even licked up the water that was all around the altar that they poured there. And when the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, "The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God." Understandably, Elijah just barely finished his petition with God answering to send the fire, not only consume the bull but that I, Elijah, had drenched with water, but the stone altar as well. It was as if the starship Enterprise was in orbit and it put its main phaser banks on full power and aimed it at Mount Carmel. Everything vaporized, even the stone. And the people got the message. They called out the meaning of Elijah's name and exclaimed that Yahweh alone was God, the Lord is God. And Elijah commanded that those 850 prophets of Baal and Asherah be seized and executed according to the law of God written in Deuteronomy chapter 7. I won't quote it here, but you can read it for yourself. And when that was done, Elijah prayed that God would end the drought. And he sent his assistants out to watch for the approaching clouds coming. At first, the cloud was very small, and then it increased. It got darker and darker, and it started to rain, started to pour. You may wonder, why would Elijah associate with Ahab, the king? Why he would leave that place and accompany the king to Jezreel, which was where they lived? I don't know for sure, but perhaps he was hoping that the Lord would enable him to put the final nail in Baal's coffin by eliminating that evil queen Jezebel. That Ahab would repent of his sin and lead the entire nation to return to worshiping God and God alone. Elijah may have had dreams to be placed in the palace as the prophet in residence, so to speak. I don't know if you did your reading, but to know it's not what happened. Ahab arrived home in his summer palace in Jezreel with Elijah running ahead of him 100 miles. He ran nonstop 100 miles with superhuman strength that God had given him to get there before Ahab had arrived. I imagine the weak king was still excited about the events of that day, the amazing presence of Jehovah on Mount Carmel and the joy of the rain falling on the kingdom once again. And as he entered the palace, he called Queen Jezebel, Ahab did, to share the adventures he'd experienced with Elijah. But the story of the power of the living God, the fire from heaven, the thunder and the rain that came after Elijah prayed, all this was drowned out when King got around to mentioning to Jezebel the elimination of 850 of her prophets according to Elijah's order. At that point, all the wrath of hell poured out of the mouth of this demonic woman as she expressed her desire to end the life of just one more prophet. King Ahab's excitement faded as he stood by passively and let his queen take the matters into his own hands as she proceeded to put a contract out on the life of Elijah. There's no doubt who wore the pants in that family. And if you look at 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 to 4, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, how he killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent this message to Elijah, "So that the gods, may the gods do to me and more also, if I do not take your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid. And he rose and he ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs in Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, "Is it enough now, O Lord? Take away my life, for I'm no better than my father's." He ran away from the adversity of Queen Jezebel. You'd think that after his success in Mount Carmel, after witnessing God's power and killing 850 false prophets, you would think that after all this, when Elijah heard Jezebel's threat, he would say, "Bring it on, baby, bring it on." But that's not what he did. That's not what happened. No, this powerful man of God ran for his life and hid in the desert, where he became seriously depressed. I don't know about you, but this is a part of Elijah's story that encourages me, because that's how my life has been at times. I found out that after victories, there are almost always a time when I feel down and despondent. That I had a mountaintop experience and I find myself then in the valley. After the good days come the bad ones, and that's what Elijah felt like. At one point he felt like he was on top of the world, and the next he was a wanted man, depressed and ready to give up on life. We would do well to remember that in our own pilgrimage through life. Life is not just one long joy that gets better and better and better and better and better. No, there are mountains and valleys, highs and lows. When in the midst of a low, we should remember that a high will come as well. As the psalmist puts it, "Weeping may remain for the night, but joy comes in the morning." The same is true for Elijah. There are other mountaintop experiences ahead for him. Even though he got so sad that he prayed to die, he never did. 2 Kings tells us that God simply took him straight to heaven when he died. Elijah sat there under a juniper tree, praying that God would take his life, and an angel appeared to him. And listen to what he said in 1 Kings 19, verses 5 to 9. The angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." Elijah looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time, and he touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." And he lay down, slept under a broom tree. Behold, an angel touched him, and she said to him, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came for a second time and touched him and said, "Arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you." And he arose, and he ate, and he drank, and went on the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. There he came to a cave, and he lodged in it. Behold, the word of the Lord came to him. He said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" In other words, "Elijah, what has brought you to this point? Why are you so depressed? Why are you hiding in a cave?" I think it would be a question for us to look at this morning, because as I inferred, we all deal with discouraging times. We all have our cave times. So what brought Elijah to this point? What did he do wrong? How did he get this depression in the first place? I'd like to advance three reasons I think that happened. First, he forgot he was human. Think of it. Elijah was just spent an exhausting day in the hot sun in his duel with the prophets of Baal. In a very real sense, he had preached all day. I remember reading somewhere that a 30-minute sermon was the same physically exhausting as 8 hours of manual labor. I don't know about that, but sometimes I take a nap on Sunday afternoons. Elijah had been going at it for much longer than 30 minutes. Plus, he had just run well over 100 miles. Most of it through the desert. No wonder he felt down. I know you've probably seen this on TV, the Energizer Bunny. He just keeps going, 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 going. Well, that gets your attention, but they don't tell you that his batteries eventually run out. No battery lasts forever. They may go on longer than their competitors, but they don't keep going. And the bunny eventually stops. He runs out of power. And so do humans, so do we. But Elijah forgot this too. He forgot that even though he was a prophet, God's messenger, he was still a human one, and humans need food and rest. Which is why the first thing God did was get Elijah to sleep and eat. You know, some people act like it's spiritually mature to go and go and go and go and go and go and go. That's an indication. They say that's an indication you have a close walk with God because you never get tired. You just go on and on. I don't believe that's true. The Bible commands us to take care of our bodies. So that sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is take a nap so you can get the strength to do more for your God. After all, we're only human. We need to stop running ourselves into the ground and take care of this physical body that God has given us. We need to quit abusing it and learn to eat right and sleep right. Lest you think this is a nutrition lecture this morning, it's not. You know, there's an old Greek saying that goes like this: you will break the bow if you keep it always bent. You'll break the bow if you keep it always bent. In other words, if you're living under constant, relentless physical stress, you'll eventually break under pressure. You have to give yourself time for rest and refreshment. Elijah forgot this. That's one thing that brought him to this depression. Second mistake that Elijah made was to think that he was a failure and that his life work was over. Remember, he said, I'm no better than my ancestors. In other words, I'm done. First time I read this, I thought, why would Elijah believe this? Look at what he did. But I read something else this week, something that helped me understand. I read that part of being human is that our brains tend to remember failures much better than we do victories. We tend to remember failures much better than we do victories. Psychologist Les Parrott tells us that failures tend to take on a life of their own because the brain remembers incomplete tasks or failures longer than any successes or completed activity. It's referred to as the Zeigarnik effect. When a project or a thought is completed, the brain places it in a special memory. Since it's completed, the brain no longer gives that project priority or active working status. And the bits and pieces of that achieved situation begin to decay. But failures in the human brain have no such closure. The brain continues to spin the memory of that failure, trying to come up with a way to fix the mess, to move it from active to inactive status. I don't know about you, but that fits for me. Because I can tell you all the things I've done wrong a lot better, a lot faster than I can tell you all the things that I've done right. I ruminate sometimes on my failures and things I've done that have hurt people badly. Didn't mean to hurt them, but I've hurt them badly. And I carry that with me. And even to sin in my life, in my past sin, I sometimes hang on to that, go back to ruminate about that more and more, rather than accept God's forgiveness and go on from there, that God has new things for me to do. I don't know, maybe you're not like that, but I certainly am. This is why we tend to remember that some of our failures so long, remember them better than we do our successes. And this is what happened to Elijah. The memory of his failure to fix the problem of Ahab and Jezebel eclipsed the memory of his victory at Mount Carmel. He wasn't a failure, far from it. Plus, there were other victories ahead. In fact, to help him see this, after Elijah got some food and rest, God gave him assignments. He told him that two kings needed crowning. He also had his prophetic successor, Elisha, to anoint and appoint. One other thing we should remember is that when we feel like failures, that we will never know all our successes, all the ways God used us to further his kingdom until we really get to heaven. Not long ago, I got an email on mail of a fellow student I taught at Crandall. And I met him at a Camp Schichtahawk up in Carrollton County and at summer camp. And I talked to him about coming to Crandall, or ABC it was in those days, to study there after he finished high school. And he came there, and God called him to the ministry. And he said to me on Facebook, I don't know if you remember, but you're the one that got me into the ministry. I didn't remember that. Not at all. I remember meeting him and talking to him, getting to know him a little. But I hadn't remembered that he used those encounters as an 18-year-old guy to end up in the ministry. That was furthest from my memory, from my mind. Only when we're able to look back and see the harvest that's been reaped by the seeds we sow, and we won't be able to do that until we get to heaven unless somebody tells us on this earth. Many of you invited non-Christians to come to church in some of our programs. Some of them declined the invitation. That may feel like a failure to you, but declining your invite may make it harder for them to decline your invite or decline one in the future that somebody else invites them. God may even have used your inviting, even though you don't see it as successful. We must remember that success for a Christian is defined as simply being obedient. Elijah's third mistake is that he forgot to practice what he preached. When Elijah realized that his victory on Mount Carmel had not changed Ahab, and when he heard that Jezebel was out to get him, when he heard she had pledged to kill him within 24 hours, he forgot that Yahweh alone, not Jezebel, Yahweh is God, and he ran for the hills. The fearful prophet took his eyes off God and focused instead on Jezebel and her soldiers, and despair was the consequence. This should help us to realize that when life's inevitable problems approach, we dare not take our eyes off our loving Heavenly Father, because when we focus our life's gaze on our problems and difficulties, we lose the proper perspective and the spiritual power that goes along with it. Then, in essence, we open the doors of our hearts and minds so depression can come in and make itself at home with us. Isaiah 26:3 says, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee." So when our own times of depression come, we must keep our eyes on God. We must dwell in God's greatness and power. We must remember all the ways that he has been faithful to us. It reminded me just right now of a story in my teenage years when I was dating. Back then, my father's car had a bench seat, no bucket seats in those days, a bench seat in the front. And this girl, who I was kind of fond of, was sitting right over next to me. And I had her arm had one around her, and I had one of those things on the steering wheel, you know, the twirlers. You can operate the turn with one hand. Don't see them much today, but they're still around. So I was driving along, and it reminded me of this story of this man, young boy who had... I want to get away from my own story because there's some other things that aren't so good there. But this young man was dating this girl, and he was driving with his arm around her in the car. And then they eventually got married. And after a few years, they're driving along, and she's over by the door on this side, and he's behind the door on this side. And she says, "Honey, you remember when we used to date? We used to sit real close together in the car. How come we don't sit that way anymore?" He says, "I haven't moved." I love how God responded to this pouting Elijah in the scripture, 1 Kings 19, verses 9 to 14. "Then God tenderly said to him again. He came to the cave and he lodged in it, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' He said, 'I've been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant and thrown down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. And I am only one left. And they seek my life to take it away.' And he said, 'Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. Behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind tore the mountains and broke into pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord wasn't in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of a low whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and he went out and stood before the entrance of the cave, because to look at God Almighty, he took his cloak and he put it over his eyes, because to behold the Lord God Almighty would be too much for him to handle. And behold, he stood there, and a voice came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said again, "I've been very jealous for the Lord, God of hosts." And then God, after the fire, a sound of a low, small whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he came out. And there came a voice to him again, "What are you doing here?" And he told him why. In essence, God said, "Elijah, what have you been thinking all these wrong thoughts? I am definitely bigger than Jezebel. I give you a victory in Mount Carmel. I'll give you others. I'm not done with you yet. I have 7,000 in Israel still to support you, basically, whose knees have not bowed down to Baal. You need not run. You need not fear. Let me ask you today, what do you need to hear God whisper in your ear today? What is your nightmare? What is causing you to fear? What has you feeling down? What burden are you trying to bear on your own? What thing in your life looks bigger than God to you?" Perhaps it's the sin in your life. You want to know God, but you think your sin is too big to forgive. Well, if you did your reading this week, you'll know that's not true. God used another one of his prophets and his messengers, a prophet named Hosea. And I won't tell his whole story. You can read it for yourself. But to help to see that no sin keeps him from loving us. No sin keeps God from loving us and wanting us back. In fact, God loves us so much that in spite of our sin, he sent his only son, Jesus, the Messiah, that the prophets foretold about into our world. Every Christmas, we celebrate his coming and the reason behind it. Jesus came to save us from our sins. Our sins, so no sin in your life is too big for God. His grace is always sufficient. So I ask again, what do you need your Heavenly Father to whisper in your ear today? Let's all bow our heads in prayer and listen for a minute in silence to what God's saying to you today. Thank you, O God, for always being there in the storms of life and also in the quietness. Thank you for your whisper, your still small voice that you speak into our lives if we'll but listen, take the time. Teach us, O God, to learn to hear that voice as you direct us. May we learn today to present ourselves to you that we may have your direction. That in all our ways, we learn to acknowledge you, and you will give us direction for our lives. Amen.
Thank you, Michael. Let's stand together one last time for today.
give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs.
God tells us in his word that in all our ways to acknowledge him and he will direct our paths. And that even if you're here today and you feel discouraged and down, or you're not sure you have a relationship with God, just ask him to come into your heart, forgive your sin, to give you a new heart. And now as you go, may the living Christ go with you. May he go behind you to support you. May he go beside you to befriend you. May he go above you to watch over you. May he go within you to empower you, and ahead of you to show you the way. Amen.